unending quest for knowledge, science plays a starring role. And you'd think that science would be able to examine all aspects of reality. But that's not always the case. And I'm not simply referring here to taboo areas like, say, human stem cell research. There are other areas of research that are difficult to pursue because the actual subject material is prohibited, like psychedelic drugs, for instance. Despite being able to alter human consciousness in the most extraordinary way, research with psychedelics has been hindered due to the fact that they're outlawed. This is particularly the case with psilocybin, the psychedelic substance found in so-called magic mushrooms. However, if you're persistent enough and prepared to plow your way through endless red tape, you can get a license to do research. Indeed, as we shall eventually see in this film, psilocybin is now being studied for its therapeutic potential by a small group of courageous scientists. Take a walk in the woods in the autumn and you're likely to come across mushrooms. Some of these we use for food, others we assiduously avoid because they can kill us. What is not commonly known is that psilocybin, the psychedelic substance found in about 100 different species of mushroom worldwide, can be used therapeutically. The idea that a chemical found inside a fungus can have great medical utility is not as strange as it may sound. Think about penicillin, discovered in 1928 by Alexander Fleming and subsequently used as an effective antibiotic. Penicillin has saved the lives of perhaps millions of people, and it's derived from a fungus. The difference between penicillin and psilocybin is that psilocybin can be used to treat psychological dis-ease as opposed to physical dis-ease. In fact, a few generations ago, psychedelic drugs like psilocybin were researched in earnest by scientists interested in discovering more about their therapeutic potential, and results were promising. But then in the mid-1960s, things went a bit pear-shaped, and research unfortunately ground to a halt. It's an interesting and colourful story, to say the least. The most well-known psychedelic drug, and the most notorious, is, of course, LSD. And where does it come from?
There's a fungus called ergot. It's like the mold that grows on bread. Only this fungus grows on wheat, and it grows on rye. In 1938, in Switzerland, two chemists, one by the name of Hoffman, one by the name of Stahl, took an ergot derivative and made some modifications on the molecule. In 1943, Dr. Hoffman pulled this compound back out of the drawer and began to work on it, began to characterize it, resynthesized it. The compound that he had made was the first lysergic acid diethylamide, LSD. That Monday, Hoffman took the first intentional LSD trip. Now, to some extent, the mental effects of LSD depend on what's called the set and the setting. The set is what you expect to happen. It's how you feel at the moment, what you're thinking, whether you're nervous, whether you're worried, what you anticipate with the compound. The setting is just as it sounds. It's where you take it, the situation, the things surrounding you, the environment.
By the mid-1950s, research was underway looking at how LSD could be used in a therapeutic context. Men in white lab coats also tested LSD on healthy volunteers, like this artist chap.
I'm going to give you this cup that contains lysergic acid, 100 microgram. Will you drink it? How you feel?
Well, I feel very fine. I feel very buoyant and light and resilient. I feel as though this chair is not as solid as it seems to be. I have a feeling that my hands are not resting against this chair. And I see flashes of color quite a bit. I see this rug, for example, seems to have an awful lot of the complements of violet and yellow.
Did it change again?
Well, just it gets cleverer, that's all.
Clever?
Yeah.
In what way does the well, rug becomes cleverer?
It seems to feel that I'm going to watch it.
Do you have the feeling that this whole experience of yours has a special meaning to the onlookers and the crew who are taking this film?
Yes.
What kind of a meaning?
I feel as though there's some very definite driving meaning in it, and there's a spiraling arrow going to its mark. And I feel that everyone here is conscious of that feeling.
Is it some sort of an influence?
Yes.
Do you still have that pleasant feeling that you described before?
Yes, I still have it. I'll never get over it.
Now you're getting emotional again. Now look at the picture now. Look at the picture. Look at it. And just concentrate on the eyebrows. That's where you were. Just look at it. You feel happy now? Do you feel happy?
Yes.
Well, you must be, because you have tears in your eyes. Oh. Is that a beautiful experience, would you say?
I would say yes.
Describe it again.
Oh, I don't know.
Hmm?
It's just giving and...
You're doing fine. Just try to describe it.
Oh, you don't know. You want to give yourself. You want to give yourself as much as you can.
What happens when I do this?
I don't know. Sort of nothing much, except that sort of getting somewhere and you interrupted it.
I see.
Sort of irritating in a way, I suppose.
I know, but I thought that maybe we can rest a little bit, because this experience was getting to be a little overwhelming, isn't that right?
Well, I wouldn't say. I'd like to keep it up.
3:05. This is where the LSD effect usually goes into a decline. But Bill is still at it.
But such a benevolence.
What do you mean?
I feel very benevolent. I mean, I feel as though I have no enemies in the world, and this is very lovely.
Do you feel
very fragile, delicate, lovely? And it goes and comes, you know. I mean, mm-hmm. That one state there that was, oh, I never experienced anything like that. It's marvelous.
Promising findings. Meanwhile, elsewhere, the hunt was on to locate the sacred psychedelic mushrooms being used by shamans in the secretive backwaters of Mexico.
In their never-ending search for the miracle weapon, CIA operatives searched here in the remote mountain areas of southern Mexico for what up to then had been considered a myth, magic mushrooms. They used this man, a part-time chemist for the CIA, to dupe this man, a vice president of a bank and an amateur mycologist or mushroom expert, to try to get to the magic mushrooms and turn them into a drug. But it would be the amateur, R. Gordon Wasson, and his colleagues who would win the race and develop the drug psilocybin from the magic mushrooms.
We went into the Mazatec area, far from the highways, remote from Mexico City. There we found that rotten bagas, as it's called, bagasso, covered with mushrooms. These mushrooms I didn't know, had never seen. They were the sacred mushrooms.
Wasson would also discover and record the ancient mystical rites of the mushrooms from a local shaman or magical priestess, Maria Sabina.
And we were seeing incredible sights. They would go slowly or they would go fast as I ordained. All your senses are rendered acute. We say that you see visions, you see hallucinations, but that doesn't begin to tell the story. The hallucinations are only part of it. You hear sounds, you smell things. The night was thrilling.
Despite the profound effects of psilocybin, it was LSD that became the most researched psychedelic drug in the 1950s. By the end of the 1950s and early 1960s, even a number of well-known celebrities were extolling the therapeutic virtues of the LSD experience. People like swimmer and actress Esther Williams, author Anaïs Nin, and actors James Coburn and Cary Grant.
In carefully controlled experiments, interesting results have been reported on the therapeutic use of LSD with the mentally ill, the drug addict, the terminal cancer patient. And in the VA hospital in Topeka, Kansas, a special research program for alcoholics.
Well, this program was started in January of this year, where we began treating 5 patients for 26 days. We bring them in on one Monday and they spend 1 week of getting acquainted, having all the tests and examinations done to keep them busy for the whole week, day and night practically. The second Monday we give them a small dose of LSD in the 5-man ward together. This is to help the group pull together and in their group experience during its 26 days to also get some good from this. Then the third Monday, we give them a larger dose individually and have each one of them cared for by one of these teams who have associated with them, and they give them their complete support. And this is where we aim for the so-called psychedelic experience. The thing that affected me as far as the first patient is concerned was the openness which he talked with me. The quality also seemed to be more realistic than he has shown before.
These qualities in my head, the good qualities, of course, virtue, love, trust. Then I seen the other ones, hate, anger, distrust. I seen them all in my head, and it was like I was strangling myself, like I had to get rid of all the bad qualities, and I was strangling myself fighting against them.
And especially the looking at the two sides in his head in this process, these things were thought about rather deeply, and the thing that makes the difference here is the emotion that goes along with them.
And I just reached up, and it was like somebody grabbed me and brought me up.
Mm-hmm.
And I interpret this as, for the first time in my life, I wanted love. And I think this is the thing that was probably my biggest problem, is that I thought everybody was forcing it on me, and I wasn't going to let them.
Yeah.
But it's not a question
I think
forcing,
from hearing this man report his experience that... there definitely is a change as of now. As far as prognosis is concerned, time.
Should the federal government exercise any control over these drugs? And if so, why?
It's a simple matter from our point of view that you can't let something get out into general distribution until it has shown some therapeutic potential. And it has shown it under certain conditions, and you can predict fairly well what's going to happen when you give this drug to a large number of people. This hasn't been shown yet. So we have to be very careful in trying to carry out the necessary research that's going to establish whether or not it has a significant therapeutic potential for people.
I would assume that LSD, like many other biotics or chemicals, will have many very fine and efficacious uses for the benefit of mankind. I would say that that's probably a certainty. But it is as dangerous, more so, than dynamite or a nuclear bomb.
Why, there's enough there to blow this building off its foundation.
Very dangerous business, clear through.
Well, regardless of this grave nuclear threat, LSD use did become more and more popular. As for the psilocybin mushroom, this remained in the background because back in the 1960s, it was not known that they grew right across the world and not just in Mexico. Moreover, LSD was relatively easy to manufacture and distribute.
The pot and psychedelic cult, whatever else it may be, is new and different. Unlike the nihilist beatniks of a few years back, today's LSD cultists say that they are turned on, not turned off. And if they talk of dropping out, they do so because they reject square society and claim they can build a better one. The psychedelic people are not in the historic pattern of dope addiction. Their drugs are so-called head drugs, ranging from such natural substances as marijuana and hashish to LSD and other artificial concoctions. These head drugs are not physically addictive, as are such body drugs as opium, heroin, and alcohol. An LSD enthusiast will inveigh against liquor as fervently as a 19th century temperance crusader.
At the center of this LSD movement was one man, loved by the counterculture and despised by the authorities.
Dr. Timothy Leary, the 1960s Johnny Appleseed of LSD.
Dr. Leary, how do you evaluate your influence on the increase in the use of hallucinogenic drugs by college students?
Well, I want to make it clear that I didn't invent LSD. God made LSD, the evolutionary process. LSD has been used in its plant form for thousands of years. Nor have I been a pusher or a advocate of LSD. I have been in the position of a prophet who's been pointing out to his fellow man that this was going to happen. 7, 6, 5 years ago, several of us from Harvard went down to Washington. We told the FDA, hey, listen, there's going to be an LSD boom. It can't be stopped. It's going to be used. It's going to take over. You better be ready for it. Then I'm in the unfortunate position of Cassandra, who when the hurricane occurs is blamed for it. Far from telling people they should take LSD, my message to young people is, since you're going to take it anyway, be careful when you take it. Take it for the right reasons. Take it in a sense of seriousness and take it well prepared. And don't take it unless you know what you're getting into.
Now, don't you feel that it's wrong to encourage the use of these illegal drugs by college students? This is, in effect, isn't it, encouraging the breaking of a law?
Well, I never tell anyone what to do with their body, because what we're talking about here is the first and last frontier freedom, my body. Now, who touches my body, or what touches my body, or what goes into my body, that's the last and first frontier of my divinity. And I have to say to Caesar, as every religious spokesman has done for the last few thousand years, Caesar, I render unto you what belongs to you out there, in the highways and the byways and the weapons and the banks. But I reserve my right to do within my own body what feels right to me. There can be no laws about what goes on inside a person's body.
One final question, Dr. Leary. How will you explain, or how do you explain, the rather unconventional attire that you have on at this time?
Unconventional? My dear Carl, this is the most orthodox attire that a man can wear. What you're wearing, a tie and that funny suit, is that's a fad. That's only been around for 20 or 30 years. I'm wearing the ancient garb of my profession, which is prophet, which is part-time would-be holy man. I'm the orthodox person. You know, as Alan Watts says, there's nothing as far out as a square. Just look at the way he acts and dresses.
Eventually, Leary was jailed on a trumped-up charge of cannabis possession. Nonetheless, psychedelic drugs were well and truly out of the bag.
Even Dr. Leary would agree that LSD presents more serious problems. The pot smoker is a pleasure seeker, but the LSD user professes higher motives, ranging from the liberation of the individual to the salvation of the world. At the same time, a bad trip can be disastrous. Several recent studies now have tentatively linked LSD with genetic damage and leukemia.
What? Genetic damage and leukemia? Get the f***.
We must assume that that person who has taken the LSD, and we can demonstrate these shattered genes in LSD takers, has become genetically different. He has mutated,
The birth of the psychedelic X-Men.
And we must assume that he will produce abnormal progeny. It is a very, very frightening thought. We don't know what sort of abnormalities to expect. We have no idea.
The whole subject is so new that research has scarcely begun. The psychedelic people claim that theirs is the real world, that the straight or square world is unreal. Be that as it may, and for better or for worse, the evidence is overwhelming that in terms of the number of people involved, especially young people, the psychedelic world is growing and growing rapidly. Good evening.
So here we are, 50 years on from the cultural upheavals of the 1960s, and psilocybin is still a prohibited substance. Yet science is once more examining psilocybin because, let's face it, the psychedelic experience that it initiates will always be fascinating for psychological reasons, for philosophical reasons, and for therapeutic reasons. One of the leading organizations involved in this scientific resurgence is the Heffter Research Institute. I spoke to the co-founder about why he set up the Heffter, and also spoke to other Heffter members about the kinds of research they're doing.
I founded the Heffter Institute in 1993 because of the absence of clinical studies. I had done preclinical work with molecular biology, receptor preparations, rats, etc. But no one was doing any clinical work, and it really upset me. And so I didn't have an MD and couldn't give drugs to humans. So I called a number of friends, some of which had MDs, and said, how would you like to start an institute to study psychedelics? And they were all very enthusiastic, and that's how it got started, really.
There's something of basic importance that we all believe resides within the study of the psychedelic experience, and psilocybin experience in particular. And I think that's what ties us together as a group, and it's the inspiration of that that has led to the whole research program at Heffter. Our initial studies were in healthy volunteers, and what we showed is that a large percentage of those people had what we call a classic mystical type experience. That is a transpersonal experience that includes a sense of unity and sacredness, and this sense of the experience is more real than normal everyday reality, open-heartedness, a sense of transcendence of time and space, and ineffability. And that experience is deeply valued. It's thought to be deeply meaningful. Many people relate it to be among the most meaningful and spiritually significant experiences of their lives.
Mystical experience was always thought as something of a gift. It happens to you if you're lucky, and many people strive for it all their lives and they don't get the benefit of a mystical experience. Well, now with 30 milligrams of psilocybin under the right circumstances, we can reliably induce mystical experiences. So it gives us, and mystical experiences are among the most meaningful life experiences that people have. So we now have a tool that we can use scientifically to study that state of mind.
So this power of psilocybin to provoke a mystical experience, what are the implications?
The implications are mind-boggling on any number of levels. What is the nature of that experience? Why do we have those experiences? What do they mean? Is there existential information hidden within the fact that we have these experiences that look to be very similar to classically occurring mystical type experiences experienced throughout the ages by mystics and people in traditional religious situations. What comes across most powerfully out of these experiences is that consciousness is incredible. It's there to be investigated. There's nothing to be fearful about. It's this marvelous display that's constantly changing. And so most often what happens with engagement with experiences of this sort is there becomes a much deeper respect and appreciation for the creative power of consciousness.
Apart from documenting psilocybin's transcendental power, another key area of study is its use in treating anxiety and depression in patients suffering from end-stage cancer. This was what got Bill Linton, the CEO of life science company Promega, interested in joining the Heffter.
Well, I was interested 5 or 6 years ago in the outcomes of research involving psychedelics and specifically psilocybin. And that was a result of a friend of mine who had terminal cancer. She was in distress, anxiety, and depression. And I was introduced to Roland Griffiths and found out about the research that he was doing at Johns Hopkins. And I went out to visit with him and spoke with him, and then I got her into the program. And she had one day of treatment, and for the remainder of her life, which was only 4 or 5 months, she was a changed person. I mean, she had really lifted from depression, and it really had made a significant impact. So that prompted my curiosity about where else is the research happening and who else is involved. And as I met the people involved, all of those people were associated with the Heffter Research Institute.
If the Heffter are getting good results, then one wonders why psilocybin research is not more prevalent.
Well, you know, we had this cultural trauma back in the 1960s in which the psychedelics were really demonized. They were thought to be so dangerous and toxic that it was inappropriate, if not unethical, to continue to study them. Much of that, as it now has come to be known, was a misreading of the literature and the case reports and the anecdotal reports. So I think the psychedelics really got an unfair shake in the 1960s.
We know so much more about brain science, and we know a lot more about how to properly design these studies so they're scientifically valid, and no critic can fault the methodologies. That was one of the problems with the early science in the 60s. I think one of the problems was the scientists themselves sometimes got caught up in this to such an extent that they lost their objectivity. And it's hard to keep your objectivity. These are interesting, amazing substances, but it's not only is it time, it's way past time for science to again look at this in a very intense way, in a very careful and rigorous way, because we can't afford not to.
So what's the prognosis? How can psilocybin be more freely investigated and integrated within our culture?
Unless there's a fundamental shift in society's perspective, this notion of how dangerous drugs are is so built into society that I don't know that it'll be the case anytime soon that people can just go get psilocybin. Now, it may be the case that they will stop prosecuting people for possession of psychedelics. And that's going to be a parallel to what's happening, say, with cannabis, medical cannabis. I think it's an evolutionary process in terms of our culture and our society. And personally, I don't think it's going to happen very fast. But I didn't think we'd be at this point in time with psilocybin in the research we are now either, thinking about a phase 3 study. Maybe things will happen faster as the younger generation grows up. Maybe attitudes will change. But from my perspective, I think it will be some time before we get to that point.
Let's go back to the use of psilocybin to treat anxiety and depression in people suffering from end-stage cancer. This raises the question about the rest of us, because we're all fated to die at some point. Author Aldous Huxley directly alluded to this in his last book, the utopian novel Island, in which his fictional islanders make use of a psychedelic mushroom in their spiritual rites. Take 400 milligrams of Moksha medicine and find out for yourself what it does, what it can tell you about your own nature, about this strange world you've got to live in, learn in, suffer in, and finally die in. Yes, even you will have to die one day. Maybe 50 years from now, maybe tomorrow. Who knows? But it's going to happen, and one's a fool if one doesn't prepare for it. So you'd think that Moksha medicine should be in some way available to every mortal adult, right? And maybe science can help move things forward.
We have been administering psilocybin to medically distressed people, but equally as important would be their caregivers. You know, we're working in an interdependent situation, and so there are some people who speak of research with the goal of betterment for well people. That's something that we're not targeted toward right now. It's a legitimate question to ask, but I think at this moment in time, it's politically very unlikely.
At this point, this is not something that society is ready to embrace, and we really don't have the structure within society to embrace this kind of an approach. But I think the topic of death and the fact of our mortality is something that a lot of people struggle with all the time. A lot of people don't like to think about the fact that as living beings at some point they're going to pass away. This life to death transition is very distressing for a lot of people. It creates anxiety with people, and particularly with a medical diagnosis that shortens that perspective. That's where a lot of this distress comes from. But with the outcomes that we're seeing, with the research that we're doing, it could clearly have an impact on normal people, but I think only on people that are ready to accept that and with a society that is both capable and ready of accepting this type of therapy.
I think what the Heffter Research Institute recognizes is that to change our cultural understanding and perception and to document safety and benefits, we need first to work through what our culture values, and that is the scientific method, and then two, look for targets that are medically acceptable and culturally acceptable, and then from then on, it unfolds. But I could imagine if I just let myself go, thinking that, yeah, perhaps this could be an experience offered to anyone over some age as they start contemplating end of life. And if that were culturally accepted and turned out to have beneficial effects, then perhaps that transition could come earlier. Yeah. But these would be transition points in life. There's no question that these agents could potentially be very powerful. Exactly how that would play out, you know, culturally and how you'd optimize that use and manage the societal anxiety, the idea of, you know, legalization or making these compounds available wholesale to the population. That's the tricky political question.
It certainly is a tricky question. Yet psilocybin is likely of more importance now than it's ever been. That's because one of its chief virtues is its potential to mitigate nature deficit disorder, namely our unhealthy relationship with the rest of the web of life. And it's our unhealthy relationship with the rest of the biosphere that is hastening global catastrophe. Back in the 1960s, psychedelics undoubtedly had a role to play in the birth of the environmental movement, particularly after we first saw the famous Earthrise picture in 1968. With climate change, resource depletion, and ecological devastation at an all-time high, we clearly need to heal our estrangement with nature and transcend our relentless obsession with materialism. In other words, we need strong medicine.
That's a very interesting proposition, the idea that these experiences can counteract nature deficit disorder. You know, the environmental sensitivity to the interconnectedness of us within the planet and in our ecosphere and within the cosmos flows very naturally out of the classic mystical experience, because at its core, it's this sense of oneness, the interconnectedness of all things, the sacredness of that, the importance of that, the benevolence of that.
Judeo-Christianism, or what you might call the Abrahamic religions, have been pounding it into our head for at least 2,000 years that nature has no value, corporeal existence has no value, you know, your reward is in heaven. So that's tended in the Western mind to devalue nature, and that's just the wrong thing, because then it says nature is of no value, so you can despoil it and destroy it. You know, there's just one problem. If we do that, we destroy ourselves. So we have to, I really think ayahuasca and psilocybin and these other things, but those two, they're really helping, they're catalysts to help us rediscover nature and wake up to our own nature in the process.
Even Carl Sagan, champion of science, endorsed spirituality, speaking of it in terms of a kind of pantheistic felt connection with the rest of nature. And that's exactly what psilocybin can potentially facilitate. Like I said, we surely need to embrace the psilocybin experience more now than we did back in the 1950s and 60s.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think Bob Jesse would argue that that can produce that primary experience. That's what religion originally was, our connection with the One. We've lost it, and that's just part of what's led to this spiritual desolation in Western society today. There's no connection with that anymore. The sacred has mainly disappeared, and churches have become social clubs. In America, the goal has been to get rich. And there's a fundamentally dysfunctional view that we have about the goal being rich. And I think that relates to the fact that we've lost our spiritual bearing in the United States, especially.
As to the criticism that a spiritually charged psychedelic experience is simply nothing more than brain activity, does it really matter? Because all and any experience that we have is likely connected to brain activity.
This transcendental experience, people that talk about spiritual personal growth, does it arise as a result of the neurochemistry in the brain, or is it some connection with the universal one, the one mind, or whatever? And it's correlative because the neurochemistry changes. So whether it's actually feeding through the brain or whether produced in the brain, I don't know that you can ever know. But I think fundamentally looking at what happens during a peak experience, one of these mystical experiences, and being able to see that in the brain in real time with magnetoencephalography or whatever, and finding out, we're going to learn a lot about how the brain actually works. It won't tell us whether it originates from the brain or whether it's correlative, but I think it's just two sides of the same coin, and it's all interesting to me. The question is how people are healed by this. What actually happens is some kind of a reboot of the brain that throws out dysfunctional subroutines that have been built up over years, or that process of having that happen, the healing process, I think, is of fundamental interest. Now, does it arise from the neurochemistry or not? I'm not really sure, but we can certainly look at the correlations and see what changes in the brain when that happens, the before and after.
Psilocybin or psychedelics are very much as much a scientific instrument as a telescope or a microscope. They give you a lens with which to examine nature from a perspective that it's never been examined before. So with the tool of psilocybin, or with the lens of psilocybin, we actually have to go back and re-examine all of science. Yeah. Because there are aspects of phenomenon that you only see in this altered state. And they're there when you're not altered, but we just don't notice them. We're genetically and evolutionarily programmed not to notice them, right? So that's important, that's a tool, and other people have said so, like Kerry Mullis's idea, trivially, LSD enabled him to get to the cellular level and imagine things about how it worked that no one had ever figured out or imagined, and what do you know, he gets a Nobel Prize. So there had to be some validity to that. So I think not just for spiritual exploration and not just for therapeutic applications, but as an actual scientific instrument to re-understand the nature of the universe.
It seems to me that a gradual process of cultural integration is inevitable. The psychedelic experience is too powerful and too important to be stamped out by those who fear it. In fact, the harsh political demonization of psychedelics requires specific legislation which, if you examine it, is unfounded.
Drugs are scheduled by the Drug Enforcement Administration without really any input, as far as I know, from scientists. There are three prongs that have to be met, all. The first prong to be Schedule I is that the substance must have a high potential for abuse. That doesn't mean it's addictive. That just means, according to the DEA, that people take it without a prescription. The second prong that has to be met is that they have no recognized medical utility or no medical use. And the third prong is that they have no recognized safety when used under medical supervision. So you have to meet all three prongs. And of course, we know that psilocybin is safe. It's been used for millennia as mushrooms. So really, but that has not been sufficient to pull it out of Schedule I. To pull it out of Schedule I, we think you need to show a medical utility. And that's what the Heffter scientists are doing now, trying to show it has a medical utility. And then we can petition to have it taken out of Schedule I.
Yeah, I think that there'll be applications for psilocybin that will address real medical social needs. And at some point, the National Institutes on Health in the United States, other federal agencies will step out of the closet and recognize that it's safe to do, and that the benefits of doing this outweigh the risks, which frankly right now are just political risks. They're not real safety risks. I'm positive about the outlook for federal support for medical applications, but some of the more interesting questions aren't medicalized. Yeah. So when we really talk about giving psilocybin to people who have contemplative practices, when we talk about giving psilocybin to explore the nature of creativity, when we talk about giving psilocybin to explore the nature of problem solving, there's no National Institute of Health that has that as a mandate. And so it's very unlikely to be funded there. It's still gonna depend in the short term, and that could be decades yet, for interested, courageous private sector donors to step up and help make that support happen.
Interestingly, apart from being on board with the Heffter, Bill Linton has also set up the USONA Institute, which is dedicated to psychedelic therapy.
USONA has a larger mission than just psilocybin. Its initial project is focused on psilocybin and end of life, but its larger mission is to take, let's say, the broad category of plant medicines or molecules that are related to what have been known as plant medicines, and to see how these can be applied in disease states, therapeutic uses, aspects of human experience that can have positive outcomes. These are not things that people have to take on a routine basis, or they have to continually take. Sometimes a single experience can be enough of a change that that's what someone needs in their lifetime. Sometimes a revisiting of the experience is helpful to remind people of just what the potential is, and it's not that every experience is the same anyway. So I think there are lots of opportunities to look at, you know, families of compounds, to look at the combination of a material together with practices, to expand the applications in many, many different directions, therapeutic and even in taking normal people and bringing them to a newer place that develops relationships within themselves and within, between themselves and other people that would have been hard to do otherwise.
The last word from the Heffter can come from Dave Nichols, who had this to say about the kind of value change that the psilocybin experience can provoke.
You know, if people start saying, I don't really need all this money, I don't need all these things, it challenges the notion that capitalism is a system that makes things go. Expanding markets, people buying, you know, consumer capitalism, advertising. If people start getting away from that and going, well, I don't need that to be happy. I'm happy. I'm happy with my family. So there's a challenge there. And I don't know to what extent, you know, the powers that be recognize that would happen. But I think if they did recognize it, they'd say, you know, we can't really have people taking a lot of these things.
And there's the rub. The same fear that existed in the 1960s, that entrenched value systems can collapse in the wake of the psychedelic experience, is still with us. But what is there to fear, really? All that psilocybin does is unlock a new sensitivity to the world around us, forge new insights and new perspectives, and even boost creativity. Indeed, no less an icon than Steve Jobs professed to have garnered creative inspiration from his use of psychedelics. So you have to wonder how many other people out there could be similarly creatively inspired. Most important of all, perhaps, is the ability of the mushroom to highlight the interconnectedness of all life on Earth. Urban living serves to distance us from the biosphere, and this can have dire ecological consequences, as we are fast finding out. The longer we remain obsessed with our own powers, whilst ignoring the larger self-sustaining systems in which we are embedded, the longer we remain estranged from a larger wisdom. Whilst it may seem drastic and rather archaic to seek to heal our beleaguered relationship with the biosphere through psilocybin, we should remember that the mushroom is the very symbol of earthiness, and so it's natural to employ it. Moreover, in their wild state, psilocybin mushrooms are a freely available natural resource, a sort of providential gift. So here's the thing. In the UK, in America, and basically across the globe, whilst you can legally talk about psilocybin mushrooms and you can legally approach psilocybin mushrooms, as I've done here, and you can even legally, with caution of course, you can legally touch a psilocybin mushroom. But if you pick a psilocybin mushroom, whoa, it's a different matter. Then you'd be technically in possession of a Class A substance in the same category as heroin and crack cocaine, and you'd have to face the consequences if the authorities caught you. So you've been warned. It's a crazy world. Crazy. Well, with its mycelial roots set firmly within Mother Earth, let's hope that the long-revered psilocybin mushroom finds a legitimate place within human culture, not just as a therapeutic agent, but as a boon to the human spirit, and not a moment too soon. Feel like Dr. Strangelove.